Cool. Thank y'all so much for being here with us today. We want to bring you up to date on escape and also the capture of Wilson and Michael Wilson. And so also talk about the timeline of when, what, and where, and answer any questions you might have. Let's first talk about the capture. He was captured a little while ago in by Harrison County Sheriff deputies. And I would like to comment that it was without event, but it's kind of an interesting way that he was captured. He was riding in a car with a lady that had picked him up to give him a ride, and she realized he was probably going to hijack her car because he kept looking at the gas gauge. And so finally, when she realized that, well, then they had a little bit of altercation, not very much in the car, but anyway, took the car away from her. And so she goes running down the road and finds a ride and gets them to tell the police. And so then they find the car and start to pursue the car. And then he starts to speed up. And just when he starts to speed the car up so he can run away from the police, he runs out of gas. So he coasts over to the side, caught and captured with no event, really. So anyway, he run out of gas, just kind of like we ran out of time with him back on the Saturday and Sunday. So he is captured, he's back, he'll be at CMCF in another 45, 50 minutes, and we'll go out and talk to him and interview him and find out all we can about how, what, when, and where he got away from us. And after that, we'll take him to reside at Walnut Grove. So he'll have a hard time getting away from us there. Won't happen again. Anyway, and do you want me to talk to you about the timeline? Because I think everybody's interested in that. And what I have to tell you about that is, the timeline is far, far too long. It's unacceptable. And what happened, we had a glitch ourselves, a big glitch. And with what happened with us at CMCF, we can tell you about it. And we can tell you about the details and the time. But what else is important is, at this point, there's 12 employees that have disciplinary action they're facing. And so, and it's severe. So therefore, unacceptable behavior with them. What he did in the timeline is at 6:30 a.m. Saturday morning, he escaped over the 12-foot razor wire fence on the southern boundary. He went there at 7:24. The fire department received a call to the subdivision where Wilson solicited an ambulance to go. He told the guy there that he was an FBI agent. He had wrecked his motorcycle, and he was bleeding, and the guy saw that he was bleeding from the cuts in the razor wire and so forth. But anyway, the ambulance took him then on to the hospital. And so from there, 7:34, let's see, the MFD arrived at 126 Cedarbrook Road behind a prison along with Rankin County Sheriff. Wilson said he's the FBI guy. He went on then to the hospital at 8:42. He arrived at UMC Medical Center at 3 p.m. He was released and went down 49 to Richland, first to Walmart, then O'Reilly's Auto Parts at 4:30. Richland police were summoned to O'Reilly's because Wilson was still bleeding profusely at the parts store from the cuts in the razor wire. He uses a story alias again. David McGinn, who he used when he escaped before, said he'd been in a car wreck. He was transported by ambulance again to UMCC. And from there, he was discharged at 4 a.m. from UMMC. And 7 a.m., Wilson is spotted on State Street by U.S. Marshals. And I'd like to comment about the support we had from the U.S. Marshals, from all the law enforcement, from wildlife and fisheries, from the state police, from everybody joined together. All the sheriff's department worked really hard to find him and to chase him and do the most they could to provide public safety. And then he's finally at 12:45 today. He was apprehended in Harrison County by Harrison County Sheriff's Office after he had assaulted a woman in Jackson County and carjacked a car, 2007 Blue Buick LeSabre. Okay, and ran out of gas. So that was cool. Anyway, we made mistakes, when he escaped, gone to the hospital that morning to do breathing treatments and so forth. And so what more can I say? We try to be as transparent as we can with the press. We've always done that since we've been here with MDOC. And We're transparent now, and so we're going to be ensure the public and so forth that we won't make those mistakes again, because we have taken corrective action, and we're shocked, excelled, and appalled that he got away without us having to lead time, which was a hindrance to the sheriff's department and so forth, because had they known, they would have known that he had the cuts from the razor wire. So that prolonged it, and thank God no one was injured or hurt. Any questions?
Sure. Commissioner, I know that right now it's hard for every law enforcement agency to hire enough people. There are always openings. There's always, you know, trying to bring in the right kind of people and whatever. How do you work around that when you're dealing with something like this?
Well, we work around that. We don't use a shortage of correctional officers for the mistakes we made. The mistakes were our fault, and so no blame. But what's important is that we know our governor and the lieutenant governor and the legislature have assured us that we'll be paying $18.50 an hour by July, and we hope we can fill lots of positions, and we're really going to work hard to do that and get ourselves, you know, with good coverage everywhere, make our job and life a whole lot easier, because we have a whole lot of reentry programs to do and a whole lot of good things for MDOC.
Yes, I understand the woman who he rode with today, I understand he took the car by force. Do you know if she sustained any injuries?
No. I think that she resisted somewhat, and he might have had something, but very little. No injuries to anyone, really.
Do you know how he was able to travel to Richland and to Harrison County?
Well, this is the thing. When we leave here to go from you, we just talking to you before we've talked to him. We fully expect that he's going to tell us and link all the things together. And what we do is, this is the debriefing that we always did even when I was at Angola, because our goal is not to go out there and fuss and carry on with him. Our goal is to go out there and get him to tell us everywhere he went and what he did, so then we can critique what we do so we can be better the next time this happens. As we increase our movement of inmates for all these reentry programs we have in mind, and we stop locking and feeding, and we start being really progressive with our prison to really make it change people's lives, you're going to see a little bit more of this, because they're going to have more opportunity, those who want to do bad things, and we're going to have really good security to keep that from happening.
When you say this was a mistake by some of the people that work there, are you guys suspecting it was an inside job, or can you give us some more details about that mistake?
We don't know. The biggest mistake that they made was his status was changed from closed custody when he scored the point system. When he scored 17 points on the closed custody, and 12 is a level that puts you to closed custody, to medium custody, it was taken out of maximum security. That alarms us, because the persons or persons involved with that change made a terrible mistake. So that mistake we're looking at. Other than that, it could and it could not be. It's under investigation, and we'll evaluate that. But all eyes are open on every situation there, because we have to close all the loops that wound up being open, which we intend to do.
So a man serving two life sentences was accidentally taken out of maximum security. How does that make you feel?
Make me feel bad. And I don't know that it was accidentally or how, and that's what we're really looking at, because that was really, really wrong. And so we've made a lot of changes in how that happened, and so already, so we're not going to see that again.
And just following up on that question, are there any suspicions of this being an inside job at all?
There's eyes wide open. And so if it is, we'll see it. We suspect that everything, but we really suspect nothing. So we're going to find out. That's what we're going to find out. It'll be thoroughly investigated, and if so, there'll be charges filed.
And being that he had already escaped twice prior, how does he even qualify for this point system you're referring to, the 17 points and 11 points?
How is that your question?
So being that he escaped from custody twice, you know, escaped in 2001, he escaped in 2018, how did he even qualify for that point system where he can be considered?
He didn't. He qualified to be in closed custody. He was at Wilkerson, and he got moved to CMCF, but he stayed in a medium security situation rather than going back to maximum. That's why he's going to Walnut Grove. We know what that is. I mean, that's big time.
And for Wilson, any charges?
He has pending charges for him. He has two life sentences. So you know, that, but he could get up to 5 years for escaping for us, and he also faces carjacking, assault, and also fleeing from officers. So if the district attorneys and the sheriff so desire, they can file those charges. And so we, in essence, will probably do our charges because of just the principle of it.
And Commissioner, when he approached the person in Rankin County when he initially solicited help with an ambulance, was he not still wearing his prison uniform or anything? Do you know?
He was wearing scrubs, and he got blue jeans from MTC, and because they gave him other clothes because the clothes he had were bloody. And so they had some clothes that they gave him, so he was wearing older jeans. Okay. Any other questions?
Oh, last question. So the timeline, he escaped on Saturday. When was a public alert? Was there alerted on Sunday? And so what was for the delay? What caused the delay?
There's some things I can't say because I don't want to open us up for the other inmates to know where the flaw was, because I don't want them to realize it. But anyway, we've corrected it. The public knew on Sunday afternoon about 3 o'clock we knew. So see, that timeline was way, way out of line. And so that's very, very unacceptable. And so we have corrected that, and that's why you see the disciplinary action we've taken against 12 people. And that's from people at the bottom line of it to all the way on up to the top line. So that's sad for them, but they need to really be cautious, do their job, follow the rules and regulations. Everything was in place. It was just a little bit of lax there, a lot of lax.
Commissioner, can I follow up on that? What are any of the procedures being reviewed at this point to keep this from happening again? Are you changing anything?
The procedures were there. It was all cool. It just do your job, follow the procedures. And so that's where we have the flaw.
In situations like this, do you guys usually notify, you know, hospitals and other law enforcement agencies to be on the lookout right away?
Oh, yes. Had we known, and as soon as we know, we're going to alert everybody in the community, and we're going to notify all the law enforcement, and they have what you call, you know, to put him in the system so that it flashes to everybody mechanically and automatically, electronically, that this person is on the loose, he's escaped, and so forth. So what happened to us was we were unable to do that because had we done that, Rankin County would have known, they would have known. So we made the mistake. You know, we're standing by what we did. We're going to be truthful and tell you the deal. So we messed up. But we're not going to mess up again, or these same people won't mess up. Any other questions? We want to be transparent with you all at all times and with the public, and that's what we're trying to do. And so we don't want to say exactly what, because we don't want others to know in our care. But otherwise, if he's caught, no one's hurt. Thank God for that, and the word is to death. And so we had some sleepless nights here, but anyways. And thank you all for reporting. Anything else?
You want to mention where? It's just 2 miles.
Yeah, you got the map here. This is associated with a little town, and you can see on the map where it was. You saw the picture. I questioned the pretty boy Floyd. He don't look too pretty there. You know, but anyway, what he is. So you can see where he was. He made it all the way to the coast, and that's the thing we want to know. That's what we're going to go and talk to him about and say, hey, how'd you get here, and where'd you get there, and where'd we miss you, and so forth. And so he had a lot of luck, but for the car to run out of gas, incredibly good luck for us, because then nobody had to chase him down over, what have you, and have a, you know, a wreck and so forth.
Was this a car chase at any point?
It wasn't, really. He ran out of gas. He was ready to go. They were ready to have a chase, and he presses the pedal to the metal, and it to the side. It coast over. So it was about time for us to have some luck. So thank you, Jesus. We had our luck then. So it's amusing how it ended. And it's not going to happen again because he's going to stay locked down. He will always have 17 points and stay where he stays.